This is the first of two mini tutorials that will be given by Professor Ian Ellis, who is an internationally renowned Professor of Breast Pathology based here in Nottingham. And these videos will form part of the educational portal of the UK Breast Pathology EQA scheme.
This podcast is one of a series of podcasts on aspects of breast pathology. In this presentation, we're going to look at the background information relating to histological grade in breast cancer. Histologic grade is defined as assessment of the degree of differentiation of a carcinoma. Semi-quantitative methodologies are now used for this type of approach. Essentially, what a pathologist is doing is seeing how a breast cancer looks and comparing it with how a normal breast lobule looks down the microscope, stained with an H&E section. Here's an example of a normal lobule. The circles you can see lined by purple and dark pink cells are the acinar cells of the normal lobule. There are some smaller paler cells surrounding those, which are the myoepithelial cells in the normal lobule, and the pale material around or between the circles is the stroma in the normal mammary lobule. Breast cancer arises from the lobular and ductal luminal epithelial cells, those are the dark purple circles there, and it arises from those cells, and a well-differentiated tumour will mimic the appearance of those cells, whereas an undifferentiated or poorly differentiated tumour will have no resemblance to the normal structure. And what grading tries to do is to put a quantitative figure on how closely an individual patient's breast cancer resembles the normal lobule, that is, how differentiated it is. The concept is that a well-differentiated tumour will behave well. It's thinking about doing normal things, whereas a poorly differentiated cancer is thinking about growing and is not thinking about doing normal things like secretion of proteins and glycoproteins. So there's a fundamental difference in behavioural characteristics related to how the tumour looks. So here we see an example of a well-differentiated breast cancer. You can see it's forming those dark purple and dark pink circles that are very similar to those we saw in the normal mammary lobule. So this is a grade 1 very well-differentiated breast cancer and is as close as a breast cancer can be to the normal structure. This tumour is very slow growing. It's doing many normal things rather than focusing on growing. The behavioural characteristics of this particular type of breast cancer are extremely good. You're unlikely to die from this type of breast cancer. In contrast, here we see a sheet of cancer cells. There's no evidence of gland formation. There's no resemblance to the normal lobule. Those dark figures, the sort of lettering type figures, are mitotic figures. Those are cells that are actively dividing in the tumour. And this cancer is concentrating or focusing on growth and growing. And behaviourally, it's going to behave in a more aggressive fashion. Breast cancer grading is not new. It's been known about for many years, and there are numerous publications over the years using different methodologies which has demonstrated its relationship to outcome of individual patients with breast cancer. The less differentiated breast cancer is, the more aggressive it behaves. The better differentiated, the better it behaves. And this has been demonstrated, as I say, in these many different studies. Interestingly, they have used different methodologies, and it just shows that the basic principles of grading that I've outlined to you can be reproduced using different methodologies, but the end point of behaviour is the same. Some people have criticised grading over the years. It's poorly reproducible between different pathologists. It is a subjective skill that pathologists have to learn to do. And part of the reasons of poor consistency in the past is that the criteria for grading in those various classification systems were somewhat unclear. And so what we've done in Nottingham many years ago now, but is still used internationally, is to try and put some objective criteria to grading. We look at tubule formation, those are the glands that structures in the normal breast, and see how closely the tumour, how well the tumour produces glands. We look at the nuclei in the tumour cells and see how they vary in shape and size. And we also look at the frequency of cells in division, that is the mitotic count. Each of those three variables is given a score depending on how abnormal it appears. The more abnormal, the higher the score. So in tubule formation, if there's a lot of tubule formation mimicking a normal lobule, then the score would be 1. Whereas if there's little or no tubule formation, the score would be 3. And that's similar for nuclear pleomorphism and mitotic frequency counting. If you then summate those scores, you can get an overall grade score, which produces grades of grade 1, 2 and 3. And the survival curve shows the behavioural characteristics. If you look on the left, you can see survival from 100% to 0. And if we look along the bottom of the graph, you can see the number of years the patients have been followed up. If we look, for example, at the 10-year point, and we go up from 10 years and look at those curves and see what proportion of patients have survived at that point. So if we go up to the grade 3 curve and go along, it's just under 50% of patients have survived. But if we go up from 10 years to the grade 1 line, survival curve, and go across, it's about 90% of patients have survived at 10 years. So you can see there's a huge difference in potential for survival after 10 years in patients with grade 1 breast cancers versus patients with grade 3 breast cancers. By using this methodology, a number of people have tried it out across the world, and these are studies from Australia, from the US, and from Europe, and they showed consistency in reproducibility that was satisfactory. So by using semi-objective scoring methodologies, you can get a reproducible, consistent grading classification for patients. And as a consequence of those studies, this methodology has been widely adopted across the world. It's adopted by the Royal College of Pathologists in the UK and our NHS breast screening programme, but also in Europe, internationally by the UICC and the WHO, in America by AJCC and CAP, and also internationally by the ICCR. So it's become the gold standard methodology for classification and grading of breast cancer. What is the evidence base? Well, there's some original publications that we produce from our group, but this publication from 2008 really looks at very long-term follow-up from a large series of patients in Nottingham and demonstrates the power of grading over time. And so there is a substantive evidence base for this. This was all reviewed in a review publication in 2010, authored by many breast pathologists from around the world, really encouraging all breast pathologists to use this methodology and to in their routine practice, and giving guidance on how to do that. Now, the survival curves in that particular paper are fascinating. This is looking at very, very long-term survival. The black line is grade 3 patients and the blue line is grade 2 patients. And you can see at just under 20 years that the curves cross over. And that may well be because of slightly more effective or better effect of treatment in grade 3 patients, sustaining a longer-term improved survival. That's just speculative, but it's one of the areas we're working on in our research program. I'll stop there and encourage you to watch some of the other breast pathology podcasts that we've produced. Oh, can do. It was too late now. How do I turn it off? The arrow's gone.
Just click the red.
No, I can't. The arrow's not there. It's oh, I know what happens. Hang on. Sometimes it goes down. Has it gone over there? Oh, yes, it's gone. It's sideways.